Hi, we'd like to welcome you to this special edition of the Domino Theory Television Program, which is dedicated to the Negro Leagues. And this all, of course, a part of Black History Month here in San Francisco, California. You are watching the Domino Theory Television Program, and welcome. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a picture of the NLBM, which is the Negro League Baseball Museum, located in Kansas City, Missouri. And this has particular meaning to us because of the fact that it is Black History Month, but also because of the fact that this particular entity grew from one room to a national treasure in just about 19 years. The NLBM has grown from a one-room office to one of the most important cultural facilities in the world. Has been inspired by a dream to build a permanent home in honor of this important but forgotten chapter of American history. The NLBM's objective was to accomplish what detractors said was impossible. In November 1997, that dream was realized. It features a magnificent $2.5 million 10,000 square foot state-of-the-art exhibit that attracts visitors worldwide and has amplified the rich history of the Negro Leagues. Due to the efforts of U.S. Senator Jim Talent, Republican of Missouri, and U.S. Representative Emanuel Cleaver, Democrat of Missouri, the NLBM was designated America's Negro League Baseball Museum. And this was done by the United States Congress back in 2006 and is recognized as a national treasure. This, of course, would be the Negro League Baseball Museum, located in Kansas City, Missouri.
The Newark Eagles. The Newark Eagles were the Negro National League pennant champions in 1946. Abe Manley acquired ownership of two floundering teams, the Brooklyn Eagles and the Newark Dodgers, and consolidated the two franchises into the Newark Eagles. The Eagles joined the Negro National League in 1936 and remained a highly competitive team until the league's demise in 1948. The highlight of the franchise's history was in 1946 when they won the Negro National League pennant and defeated the Kansas City Monarchs in a hard-fought seven-game World Series. The Newark Eagles.
Unlike today's major leagues, the Negro League, at the particular time that it was in existence, also allowed women players. Included in that group were Toni Stone, who you are looking at presently, Connie Morgan, and Mamie Johnson. Toni Stone was second baseman for the Indianapolis Clowns in 1953. Although she signed primarily as a gate attraction, she holds the distinction of being the first female to play in the Negro American League. During the early 1950s, the league had become strictly a minor league operation and was struggling to survive financially. Her appearance on the diamond reflected the loss of interest in organized baseball. However, she played in 50 games and hit a respectable 243. During the winter, she was traded to the Kansas City Monarchs for the 1954 season and was replaced on the Clowns by another female second baseman, Connie Martin, who played from 1954 through 1955. Mamie Peanut Johnson, the third female Negro leader, played with the Clowns from 1953 until 1955. While playing in the Negro League, Stone was knocked down by pitchers, taken out on double plays by base runners, and generally treated the same as other baseball players on the ball field. In September 1993, she was inducted into the Women's Sports Hall of Fame in Long Island, New York. That would be Miss Toni Stone. This is the legendary James Coon Papaville, born May 17, 1901. He died March 7, 1991. James Coon Papaville's professional baseball career in the Negro National League lasted from 1922 until 1950. Recognized by baseball historians as the fastest man ever to play baseball, he was clocked circling the bases at 11 seconds. James Coon Papaville's teammate and longtime friend, Cecil Page, said Coon Papa was so fast that he could flip off the light, get into bed before the light went out. Coon Papa was a switch-hitting center fielder with a lifetime batting average of .419. Coon Papa was also an accomplished coach, manager, and scout. Bell was a loyal gentleman with dignity, humility, and of course, generosity. If fans truly loved him, he fought whatever he played baseball. He could hit, throw, steal bases, and bunt. But more so, his fans came to enjoy the magic of Coon Papa Bell's flying feet. During his illustrious professional baseball career, Bell played on many teams, including three of the three greatest teams in history of the Negro League: the St. Louis Stars, the winners of the 1928, 1930, and 1931 Negro National League Championships; the powerful Pittsburgh Crawfords between 1932 and 1936, and the Homestead Grays between 1943 and 1945. For the last three of the team's nine consecutive Negro National League championships, Bell's popularity was phenomenal. He was voted to the East-West All-Star Game by fans every year from its inception in 1933 through 1944, except during the years he played in baseball in Latin America. Coon Papa played winter baseball in Cuba, Mexico, Dominican Republic, and other Latin countries. Bell had incredible hitting averages in Latin American leagues, and in 1940, playing with the Mexican League, he won the Triple Crown with a .437 batting average, 12 home runs, and 79 RBI. He also led the league in runs with 119 and triples, 15, and finished with 29 doubles and 28 stolen bases. Bell played in exhibition games against the white major league competitors, and his batting average was .391. Bell was inducted into the National Baseball Hall of Fame in 1974. The picture that you are looking at includes Coon Papa Bell's number one fan, his lovely daughter, Connie. This is a picture of the Pittsburgh Crawfords, a National League powerhouse. Formed by Gus Greenleague from a youth team in 1931, the new owner loaded the team with outstanding talent, including Satchel Paige and Josh Gibson Sr. and the Crawfords became a powerhouse for the following 5 years, between 1932 and 1936. The Crawfords played as an independent team in 1932, finishing with a 99-36 record for the season. In 1933, they joined the Negro National League and were a co-claimant to the league's first pennant. The Crawfords finished the first half with a 20-8 league record, only half a game behind the Chicago National Giants. The second half of the season was not completed, and the Chicago American Giants claimed the title. But Greenlee, as president of the league, declared the Crawfords as the champions, and the matter was never resolved. In 1934, the Crawfords fielded another outstanding team, finishing with a combined 29-7 record for a 6.630 winning percentage in league play. However, they failed to win either half of the split season and missed the playoffs. That would be the Pittsburgh Crawfords, and those are the African-American individuals that you see on your screen presently. The Pittsburgh Crawfords of the... These are the Homestead Grays, the 1939 Homestead Grays. One of the best-known black baseball teams, the Homestead Grays was organized in 1910, and Cum Posey, who would become the owner of the team, joined it as a player in 1912. Homestead was a steel mill town, and the workers at the U.S. Steel Mill formed a recreational baseball team. Posey booked all the leading teams around the Pittsburgh area, and with the Grays playing as an independent team, the team was very profitable every year from 1912 until 1929. The Grays joined the American Negro League in 1929, but the league lasted only 1 year. That would have been the Homestead Grays. These are the Newark Eagles, the Negro National League pennant champions, 1946 Newark Eagles. Abe Manley acquired ownership of two floundering teams, the Brooklyn Eagles and the New York Dodgers, Newark Dodgers rather, and consolidated the two franchises into the Newark Eagles. The Eagles joined the Negro National League in 1936 and remained a highly competitive team until the league's demise in 1948. The highlight of the franchise's history was in 1946 when they won the Negro National League pennant and defeated the Kansas City Monarchs in a hard-fought seven-game series. Some of the players that you see in front of you are from left to right, back row, Monty Irving, who made the Hall of Fame, Johnny Davis, Lenny Pearson, Lynn Hooker, Maxwell Max Manning, Cecil Cole, Rufus Woods, Larry Doby, who also went to the Hall of Fame. At middle row is, Leon Ruffin, Warren Peace, Jim Wilkes, Bobby Cotton Williams, and the Bat Boy, of course, is in there. That's on the second row. And on the first row we have, Shelton, Charles Parks, Clarence Israel, Riley Biz Mackey, Bob Harvey, and Leon Day, who also became a Hall of Famer. The Newark Eagles. The Birmingham Black Barons, a southern stronghold for nearly 20 years. Although the Black Barons had its first major success, winning the second half title in 1927, Negro National League split season, the team lost league championship series in a four-game sweep against the Chicago American Giants. The high point of Birmingham's 19-year history occurred in 1940 with all-stars such as Lorenzo Piper Davis, the first black player to sign with the Boston Red Sox in 1950, Lester Lockett, Ed Steele, and future major leaguer Artie Wilson. The Black Barons won the three Negro League American pennants in 1943, 44, and 1948. Unfortunately, after each pennant victory, the team lost the Negro World Series to the Homestead Grays. You are looking at some of the players of the Birmingham Black Barons. And if you recall, I think Michael Jordan attempted to play baseball at one time with the Barons in his later life, as you would call it, I guess. He didn't make it, of course, but anyway, history, black history, very intricate part of black history, sports, and we're glad to be able to present this to you. We hope that you enjoy the presentation, and stay tuned. We'll be back.